Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the closing session of EUBCE 2021. After four very long and very intensive days, we arrive at the end of this edition of the conference. We are here to conclude this conference and to share a few thoughts about this conference and praise the high scientific work presented during these days. We have a few important points in the agenda in this session that will include the following. First, there will be the highlights of the conference that I will provide with a general overview of advances made in different topics for biomass production, biomass conversion technologies, and sustainability impacts. Then, there will be some feedback from the industry sessions where we had so many industrial presentations showing industrial applications with significant progress being reported. Then there will be a feedback on the petition that it was proposed during this conference on the sustainable role for bioenergy and biofuels in the green transition. I hope you already signed it for. If not, there is still time. You can sign it even after the conference. During this session, there will be also time for the student awards that are given to young researchers to encourage and to praise high quality work in this field. During each edition, also the poster awards are given to highlight exceptional visual presentations that combine scientific novelty and excellence. After that, we have an overview of the conference given by Heinz Hossenbrink, with some statistics and relevant information of the conference and some images we collected remotely. At the end, Guillaume Boisenet from CEA will highlight some points he noticed during this week. I want to mention that Guillaume was part of the executive committee over the last two editions and brought invaluable support for the organization of the cover. So to some extent, he has a very significant contribution to the success of this last edition. Now it's time to go to the first point in the agenda, the highlights of the conference. So what I would like to mention, since the opening session of the conference, the main topic for discussion was sustainable bioenergy for the global bioenergy transition. This was covered widely in many presentations and discussions during the week. Next slide, please. First of all, we saw a global commitment, increasing global commitment towards decarbonization. There is a great momentum for renewable energy expansion, and we saw new developments in this direction in many areas of the world, including China, India, United States, Brazil, and of course the European Union. All sectors need to contribute to the global effort, and from agriculture and forest to industry, energy, and transport sectors. Also, aviation and maritime started to receive a lot of interest from in international initiatives and industry associations. Sustainability remains still a major concern that it was underlined during this week. Sustainability debate started a long time ago, in particular on some potential negative impacts on biofuels, on fuel security, land use change, indirect land use change, and other effects. However, multiple benefits are often overlooked in discussions, and the benefits are referring to agriculture, forestry, and industrial sectors, as well as rural development. New reinforced sustainability criteria for biomass use have been proposed in the European Union, and related legislation is under review these days to ensure even stronger sustainability constraints. Bioenergy and biofuels are indispensable, in particular in sectors that are difficult to decarbonize. Bioenergy has a higher share today of renewable sources in the energy supply, and will still have to play an important role in the energy system. In some areas such as electrification, we can say that infrastructure is not there. including recharging infrastructure. In addition, the impacts of electricity grids are underestimated. And therefore, the biofuels shall play still a significant role in the transport sector. Also, it was mentioned that internal combustion engines will play a major role in the global transportation sector in the years to come. And not only in the passenger car park, not only in the heavy transport, but also in passenger cars. A variety of resources are available, but all of them are needed. While waste and residues are the first choice, many presentations address the use of residual biomass and the cascade and circular use of biomass. Waste and residues are limited for the high ambitions for decarbonizing the global economy, and therefore dedicated energy crops are needed. Intensification of sustainable biomass production is part of the solution. While we witnessed a more international cooperation or at least agreement on the need for decarbonization, we see new innovative solutions being developed for the challenges that we are facing nowadays. There was a general agreement that we need consensus on sustainability in order to ensure that the most adequate, most promising, and most advanced solutions are deployed in order to reach the carbon neutrality targets. Next slide, please. Now I would like to go to the first topic and to mention that in this topic, the research focus was in particular on sustainable biomass potential, biomass production options and production systems that contribute to enhancing land systems and the valorization of waste and residues. On sustainable biomass potentials, we saw some interesting studies that looked into the biomass carbon sink potential of forests and soil carbon sequestration potential of bioenergy crops. We saw some tools developed to determine marginal areas and sustainable crops, or a tool for quantifying the global potential of land to achieve negative emissions through carbon sequestrations. Few presentations focused on the biomass production options integrated into traditional agroforestry systems, new biomass crops and energy grasses, as well as new production systems such as intercropping, relay cropping, or double cropping. New production systems contribute to enhancing land and improving water availability and quality of agricultural soils in the context of intensifying agriculture. Several conversion pathways address the partial carbon return to soil as a way to improving soil carbon. On waste and valorization, on waste and residues, the research interest focused on system harvesting, on systems harvesting residues and valorization of wastewater for materials and energy. Next slide, please. On topic two, biomass conversion for bioenergy, the main advances have been reported on biomass combustion, gasification, and syngas production, and biogas processes and biomass cleaning. Significant progress has been reported on small-scale combustion that succeeded to reduce emissions. Advances have been reported on biomass gasification, with research interest addressing process analysis, modeling, and optimization, and syngas production. Progress was mentioned in synthetic fuel production from biomass gasification and Fischer Tropsch synthesis. Investigations also focused on the innovative process for autothermal catalytic reforming of pyrolysis oil for syngas production. Biogas and biomethane have become a reliable solution to green transport industry and decarbonizing gas grids. There are novel process developments and pretreatment methods, as well as an innovative way of biomethanation of syngas. Next slide, please. On topic three, we saw different directions for research. And for bioalcohol production, we noticed some advances made in the production of alcohols and chemicals with using microbes, enzymes, and through process intensification. Several pretreatment strategies have been analyzed. Various biological thermochemical processes have been investigated for the production of renewable hydrocarbon biofuels. An innovative integrated process is being developed to produce synthetic fuels from sewage sludge that involve thermocatalytic reforming, hydrodeoxygenation, and pressure strain absorption. New area of interest rapidly growing refer to the co-processing of fast pyrolysis bio-oil. Significant advances have been made in the pyrolysis processes and conversion of crude oil to products, addressing fundamental and analytical aspects. An innovative route involves renewable fuel production through hydrogenation of the thermocatalytic reforming oil. New aspects were also addressed, and this they refer to the treatment of pyrolysis water. In the field of hydrothermal processing, the focus was put on the process modeling and data analysis. Advances were made in the hydroprocessing of biofuels. Innovative pathways address supercritical water gasification of wet biomass to biofuels and biomethane. On bio-based chemicals and materials, a range of products, you can go to the next slide, please. On bio-based chemicals and materials, a range of processes are being developed for converting biomass feedstocks to bio-based products and value-added chemicals. The investigated routes include enzymatic fermentation routes, as well as biochemical and thermochemical routes from waste and biogenic residues. In the area of biorefineries, new concepts were presented for biorefineries from agriculture, wood, biogenic, and municipal waste. Important advances were made in microalgae fuel process bioprocessing, innovative bioconversion of syngas and carbon dioxide into fuels and chemicals. Next slide, please. In the topic four, addressing sustainability impacts on policies, we saw some novel studies that address social impacts, behavioral analysis, and change management and socio-cultural conditions. Several studies address the life cycle environmental impact of biomass production on ecosystem services, biodiversity, and water availability. The potential feasibility and challenges for different climate mitigation strategies were also analyzed. The opportunities and challenges for evolving bioenergy and carbon capture were investigated. A new approach was proposed for addressing land use change and indirect land use change and their quantification, but by allocating the land use change emissions to all uses. On resource efficient and circular economy, I would like to mention the investigations on possible paths toward a resource efficient and carbon neutral economy. Integrating biochar into value chains in sugarcane biorefineries and carbon sequestration in soil is part of this concept that was discussed these days on circular economy. Next slide, please. The issue of development and integration of bioenergy in energy system was addressed in many presentations, looking at the various options and developments. Decision support tools were developed. The analysis and optimization of flexible solutions include various biomass hybrid systems, such as biogas, photovoltaic heat pump with biomass district heating, concentrated solar and biomass power plants. An innovative net zero route involves biogas fast pyrolysis for hydrogen production and high value carbon rich material produced for multiple uses. During the whole conference, large space was devoted to sustainable aviation fuels. The perspectives, opportunities, and challenges for sustainable aviation fuels deployment and decarbonization have been investigated. Several promising conversion pathways from various feedstocks are available, including hydrothermal liquefaction and catalytic hydroheating. The role of hydrogen in the effort to decarbonize industry, transport, and gas grids in different scenarios has been analyzed and debated. The technical options for green hydrogen production have been investigated. Next slide, please. So about industry sessions, we saw many industrial presentations or presentations coming from industry that addressed several topics. First of all, I would like to mention the presentations that focused on non-food crops cultivation, sequential cropping, new feedstocks that can bring agroeconomic and environmental benefits, dealing in addition also with the use of marginal or unutilized lands. Industry advances have been also reported on new small-scale residential biomass combustion or gasifier systems for combined heat and power. Important advances were made in industrial biomass gasification. One example is the sun gas gasification process and municipal solid waste gasification of at Fulcrum Sierra Biorefinery to produce jet fuel. Fast pyrolysis also received a lot of interest, and progress has been reported in commercial application of advanced bio-oil production and co-processing pyrolysis oil. Next slide, please. On biogas biomethane production, I would like to mention the production of synthetic methane through biological methanization of biogas. New advances were made in the green hydrogen production from biogas with a novel catalytic membrane reactor. New low carbon fuels are being developed in industry and applied. And I would like to mention here the integration of hydrogen and ammonia into combined cycle. A commercial plant is built by Clariant in Romania based on some liquid process to produce lignocellulosic ethanol. New zero crude Grand Puits refinery complex is planned for the production of biofuels, sustainable jet fuels, and bio-naphtha. Innovative biofuel production are being developed by bacterial conversion of carbon dioxide and renewable hydrogen from photocatalytic water splitting. Advances were made also in ethanol production from recycling carbon and bioethanol production through enzymatic hydrolysis of biomass and fermentation. On bio-based products, industry provided insights into sustainable solutions for plastic and chemical industries with using bio-based feedstocks. I think this is all that I prepared as highlights. I would like now to thank to the whole scientific committee for their invaluable contribution to preparing this high scientific program of the conference, and the many thanks for the organizers for making this conference possible, and I would say with the almost perfect organization. I would like also to thank to all the speakers and of the sessions and session chairs that provided me with material for the highlights during the conference. Last but not least, I'd like to thank to all attendees that allocated so much time in allowing all the sessions, in following all the sessions and various events of the conference. This is all. Now I would like to pass the floor to Kyriakos Maniatis to give some words on industry track. Kyriakos, you have the floor.
Thank you, Nikolai. Good afternoon, everybody. It has been an intensive, challenging, but above all, very interesting and I hope rewarding 4 days for all of us. At least I enjoyed it, and like always with the EUBCE conferences, I had fun with it. Above all, I learned many things. So I'm not going to keep you very long. I would first of all like to thank Nikolai for giving the summary and the key points of the industry track sessions. And I will go very simply to show you kind of a small summary about how many participants we had on the different sessions and my own, in a way, ideas about it. So I'm not going to give any key messages, just some, I would say, summary. So on Monday, we had a panel discussion about Europe by economy. Are we going to be poised for leadership or Europe is going to miss the boat? There were two American panelists and two Europeans. Then that was followed by a visual session on sustainable resources for biodiesel, bio-based industrial processing. And you see the numbers of participants, 116 and 77. We continued then on Tuesday. We had the session on advances in methanol, hydrogen fuel cells, advances in small scale thermochemical conversion, in large scale gasification, fast pyrolysis, and low carbon fuels. And again, you see the numbers of the participants in the different sessions. Yesterday, we had five more sessions. One was on the advances in biogas and biomethane, biofossil fuels, non-food crop cultivation, bio-based products, and again, a visual session. And again, the numbers you see that there was, let's say, well attended this kind of sessions from the industry, from the participants. Finally, today, in the morning, we had a session dedicated to China, a session dedicated to India. There was another, the last visual presentation. And I would like to remind to all of you that following the closure session, we're going to have a very interesting panel discussion on refuel of the UN Aviation Initiative workshop. So just log in, it's a very interesting discussion. I'm certainly going to enjoy it. Now, if I look back, I will see that, let's say, the sessions dealing with the new fuels like methanol, hydrogen, of course, combined with fuel cells, low carbon fuels and biofuels, they have attracted the highest number of participants. But what's also very interesting for me is that also the session on bio-based products had quite a high number of participants. And this is an area that we have to try to improve in the conference, try to get more information about what's happening in addition to energy. Energy is the main focus of the conference, biomass as well. But of course, we have to see, we have to try to attract more and more participation, understanding of all the different options that we have about biomass and the bioeconomy. So I will try not to keep any further. I will try to go to the booklet on biomass progress technologies. For all of you who haven't seen it, please scroll down to the program of the industry track. Then around the fourth page, you will find it. Basically, it's a very short, but very informative template for the industry. Basically, we have here facilities that they're either large-scale pilot plants, large-scale demo plants, and commercial facilities. And basically, it's a short summary, combined together all the information of the state of the art in the various different technologies. I'm not going to show the booklet. Just what I would like to say that so far, before we start on Monday, we had 49 templates from different industries, from Europe, from the US, from India, from China. During the conference, we received two more templates, and we had at least several requests to submit new templates. So overall, I would try to say that from my side, although it was the first time that we tried to have a dedicated industry track, I find that it has been overall successful and more or less provided the information that we basically were expecting, that they will provide it towards you, towards the participants, towards the audience, to have a good understanding what happens next to the science of innovation, how is the innovation transformed into innovation in the industry, technology developers still in the ground. If we're going to meet our passive targets, we need still in the ground. So we have to move things fast. And of course, industry cannot do it together without the research and the academic community and the system. So it has to go hand in hand. And that's why we created this kind of permanent industry track to have, let's say, both sides together. Last but not least, I would like to have my sincere thanks for that, I think, for the excellent organization of the conference, the organizing committee for all the support provided, and above all to Ms. Sinu-san for the impeccable coordination she's had for the industry track, and of course to Ms. Mariela Rago for the complete facelift of the booklet, the one you see over here, and you scroll, you find it's a very nice thing. And with that, I will stop and I will pass the floor to the next speaker. Thank you for that.
I think now it's time to go to Patrick Klimborn to present a petition on the role of bioenergy in biofuels. Patrick, you have the floor.
Yes. Hello, everyone. Thank you, Nikolai. I hope you hear me well.
Switch display, please.
Okay. Now it's okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Very good. Okay, everyone. I will talk about the EUBCE petition, the indispensable role for bioenergy and biofuels in the green transition, and the results. Also, and at the bottom here, you have an important disclaimer that the views expressed are purely those of the authors and may not, under any circumstances, be regarded as an official position of the European Commission. So, This was developed as a common message from EUBCE participants. This petition is still open, so there is still time to support this message, and we will keep it open for a couple of days. So far, we have 140 signatories, so thank you, everyone. This is really good. And of course, the message is the view of the signatories and the initiators. Not the view of EUBCE or the European Commission, as I stated in the disclaimer. The initiators were the people here on the list, myself, Kyriakos, that you just heard, Uwe Fritze, Jan Bossonet, that you will hear later, Professor David Chiaramonti, Angela Grassi, and Maurizio Cocchi from ETA Florence. So we are the initiators. I will now quickly go through the signatories. You see here in very small text, so I will not read them all, but we have one list here and it goes on. This is the next page with signatories and that has been here at the conference. And one more also with people from around the world and Europe, and even one more. And the list is increasing as we speak. Looking at the country distribution, you see it here. In total, we have 37 people from 37 countries that have signed the petition. Out of those, it's 19 EU member states, participants from 19 EU member states. The next step, as also explained earlier, a petition to the European Parliament is under preparation, and also the message will be conveyed to the European Commission and the European Parliament. We hope for a constructive way forward where sustainable biomass and bioenergy and biofuels is then employed to together with all the other solutions that we need to essentially save the planet. So with that is my last slide, and thank you very much, everyone. Also been a very great conference, and it's still time to sign the petition following the online instructions. So with that, I leave over to the next speaker. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon. Nikolai, are you going to introduce us first?
Thank you, David. Now is the time for the student awards. I mentioned this topic at the beginning of this session. As always, this student award is given during the Biomass Conference to, let's say, the best scientific work made by the young researchers. And this is a way to encourage high quality and to reward high quality work. And at the beginning of the conference on Monday, we saw the Linneborn Award received by Juan Carrasco from CIETMAT at the end of his career. And I wish that some of these student awardees will receive this Linneborn Award after a few years. I hope they are still at the beginning of their career, and there are plenty of opportunities to grow and to progress in the career. I think this is all from me. David, you have the floor now for introducing the first winners.
Yes, thank you, Nikolai. As Nikolai said, I just wanted to expand a little bit just to say that we really are looking forward, and we'd really like to see some, if not all, of these people, these six winners that you now see on the screen in front of you, see them back not just next year, but for quite a few years to come, because you are a big part of the future of biomass, big part of the cleaning up the system that has been damaged by so many of the older people, the older generation. Our apologies for, or my apologies on behalf of everybody for that. Anyway, the student awards. I will go through the first three and then pass back over to Nikolai. So we'll go through topic by topic, and this is from topic one. This is for Dagmar Henner, who is from the Wegener Center for Climate and Global Change at the University of Graz in Austria. The work presented at this conference by Dagmar was bioenergy crops and options for increased soil carbon storage and water holding capacity through sustainable agriculture and forestry. And within this is modeling results from showcase regions in Austria and beyond. As we know, sustainable agriculture is a big part of producing biomass, but also maintaining the good quality of the land that we use for long into the future. As you see on the screen, we would normally invite Dagmar up to the stand for a photograph at this stage, but unfortunately, under these COVID restrictions, I'm afraid that is it. So we move on to topic two. And the winner of topic two is Marco Capiro from Politecnico Torino. Marco is a student within our age limit, which I think we have an age limit of 30 for these student awards. He's a PhD student in environment and civil engineering at the Politecnico di Torino. The work presented by Marco at this conference was the impact of biochar on anaerobic digestion of activated sludge. Biochar are an increasingly important component in so many aspects of the work. And what you see on the screen now is the award that will be sent eventually to Marco. And I congratulate, of course, Marco for his achievements and for his contribution to this conference. We then move to topic three, which is a more technology topic. And this award goes to Stef Giesels from Ghent University, Green Chemistry and Technology. Stef is also a PhD student, started work teaching assistant department of Green Chemistry and Technology. And at this conference has presented a paper on enhanced pyrolysis of lignin for the recovery of bioaromatics, a keen area of which is developing rather quickly in many areas of the world. So thank you, Steph, for this contribution to this conference. And following slide will show the award, once signed, the original will be sent to you. And I do congratulate you wholeheartedly for your contribution to this area. I now pass back to Nikolai, who will present the other three topics. Thank you, Nikolai.
Thank you. Thank you, David. I would also like to add that it was not an easy task for the committee to select the best students from all the candidates. So this is an additional recognition of the high quality of the work they did. And this shows that they have a very promising career ahead. So for the topic number four, the award winner is Hossein Beydaghi. He is a PhD student at Leipzig University and researcher at the German Biomass Research Center. And the award he received was on high quality biogenic silica production from rice husk and rice straw. We can go and see the next on this slide. No, go back, please. This is the diploma. This is the proof of his quality, high quality work. He is going to receive it next days. Okay, if we go to the topic number five, Carlotta Panzone is the winner for topic number five. He studied at chemical engineering. He studied chemical engineering in Politecnico di Torino, and now he is in Erasmus program. He works now in CEA Grenoble in France. She received the award for the study of catalytic performances and kinetics of CO2 hydrogenation reactor over a catalyst for gaseous and liquid hydrocarbon production. Next slide, we see the diploma. Congratulations, Carlotta, for the very good work. And now let's go to the last winner that received the award for the topic number six from industry sessions, Alessandra Camelo from Institute of Energy and Environment. She received this award for the work done on the potential of a new seed propagated elephant grass cultivar for bioenergy purposes. Congratulations for this work. This is the diploma received by Alessandra. She will receive it physically in the next days. Congratulations again. This is all from my side.
Hello. I'm Dimitris Sidiras. I will present the poster awards. Next slide, please. So in topic one, we have the growth analysis of Typha dominatensis pairs after being established as a floater plant. Also, we have agroforestry systems for food and energy, a case study of conventional plant production combined with short rotation copies. And we have the decentralized exploitation of biomass-derived waste and residues by pyrolysis and subsequent entrained flow gasification for gas engine use. Next, please. And an estimation of the energy potential of rice industry byproducts in Sri Lanka. And the last for topic one, biomass classification by key means clustering and correlation analysis based on compositional and pyrolysis data. Next. Yes. Now, for topic two, we have influence of different devolatilization models on CFD modeling of entrained flow gasification. Also, we have simulation of supercritical water gasification of black liquor, the fate of, I think it's CO2, yes, now I can see it, and H2S. The third one is characterization of emissions from a combustion of olive wood chips. Next, please. We also have combined storage and pretreatment process of sunflower, catch crop under alkaline conditions prior to anaerobic digestion. And the last for topic two, waste biomass as additive in high quality pellets for energy production. Next, please. Yes. So now for topic three, we have the evaluation of the influence of biological pretreatment with fungi, Pleurotus ostatus, in the improvement of alcoholic fermentation of mango residues. Also, we have evaluation and products characterization of mango seed cell and the kernel conventional pyrolysis. The third one is phosphoric acid catalyzed hydrolysis impact on the cellulose content in the wood residue after furfural production. Next. Also, we have evaluating alternative applications of hydrochar in the UK case study in inside. And the last, I think, in topic three, torrefaction of almond cells and olive stones, characterization as a potential and using agent for metallurgical industries. Next, please. Yes, and now we go to topic four. We have a sustainability assessment of the production of microbial bio-based surfactants. The second is special life cycle assessment of rapeseed-based biodiesel production in central Germany. The third one is assessment and valorization of ecosystem services in biomass cropping systems. The case of Misanthus cultivation for isobutanol production. Next, please. And the last one for topic four is strategies and technologies to achieve a European fossil energy free agriculture, Horizon 2020, agro fossil free. And now we finish for topic four, and we have for topic five the poster life cycle assessment of electromicrobial production of renewable hydrocarbon fuels. Next, please. And for the industry track, we have a mapping of marginal, underutilized, and contaminated lands in Europe and Ukraine, and sustainability assessment of bioenergy value chains through the BioPlat EU Web GIS tool. The second one is efficiency increase of a small-scale CHP plant fueled with synthesis gas originating from thermochemical recuperation. The third one is biofeed case studies, how to adapt existing industrial facilities. Is there another one? No. I think we finished. So thank you very much.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yes, Heinz. Okay. We can hear you.
Probably I'm not visible, but let me get my
yes, you are.
My presentation. Just a moment. So my, can you see my screen?
Switch to full yes. screen mode.
My problem is that I can't see it. Okay.
Heinz, swap display if possible.
Okay, now everything seemed to be fine.
Yes.
So, hello. After all the excitement about the awards, I would move over to a more relaxing part, telling something about our all virtual experience of this conference, which continues to be virtual, and we are still not able to meet each other. And so we hoped when we finished the conference last year, and we hoped COVID-19 would be over and we would be possibly able to meet, but this wasn't the case. So these are the figures of how the pandemic continued since the last 2020 edition. It got worse throughout the winter, and now it's even getting worse. And so we are really forced to stay here. But the thing which concerned me when I saw today these figures is actually the dark blue one, which is Southeast Asia, and it's actually India. And that's why I wanted to start my presentation to tell our 45 participants from India, we are with you. And we had just today a special industry session on bioeconomy advances in India. And it's like getting out our hands out to our Indian colleagues. I hope you will be in a better situation soon. Now talking about Asia, look to the right side, you see the 45 participants from Asia. We have a very strong foothold with this conference, both in Asia and South America. So almost all sessions had at least a participant from South America or from Asia. So you have 65 from Brazil, but also 23 from Colombia, 16 from China, 13 from Thailand, and from Japan. So we are quite an outreach. I assume that these participants wouldn't be here if it wouldn't be virtual, because nobody actually from these countries can travel. So that's the overall figure. These are of today, 2018 participants, which is a couple of hundreds more than on our last virtual conference in July 2020. And you can well imagine how proud everybody here is that we really hit, obviously, the nerve of many people in participation. And whilst we are not traveling, I think there will be many which wouldn't be able to afford even traveling. And so the outreach of the conference has strongly increased. Now with this virtual experience, what was new, we promised that we get more interaction into the virtual conference, and we were trying out certain things. The poster sessions became now scientific colloquia with mini orals. The same concept we applied for the business colloquia, also with small oral presentations to get people just better known and better visible. We have a very nice speakers corner in the exhibition hall in the a public forum with the many, many conversations which are going on. You saw before that one of the use will be the call to sign and petition. There were also this personal agenda, keeping track of your presentations, meetings, and contributions not to miss, that I think was very, very functional, very good. So this is a little bit the screenshot of the mini orals. So people were presenting the poster, could talk, make themselves visible, and to the right, you see all the people were actually 20, just debating about the poster. We had very, very good session chairs for the poster sessions. And at this moment, I want to give them our compliments in guiding a kind of scientific debate between the participants. And I think it was a really, really an add-on to the usual, a little bit stepped aside posters. They really became now a strong heart of the conference. As well, you could communicate directly with colleagues, as I did in this case, without going into the email and sorting out what email is now relevant. You just could directly contact them. They could directly reply to you. You could organize on your own any meeting without going through Skype, Zoom, whatever. You just got the right people there, which you picked up from the participants list of this conference in order to facilitate meeting each other. So probably you could meet even easier than on a real conference there to find some time. The conversations were quite interesting. They are brought up. Anybody who wanted to discuss something, it was a kind of conversation where people could invite. That was very lively debates went there up or could make announcements. Very similar things happened in the exhibition. The exhibition hall was visited by more than 7,000, almost 8,000 visitors throughout the week, very often during lunch breaks or coffee breaks. Also there was the speaker's corner, which I want to show a little bit how it was looking like. So everybody who had a very interesting theme could get into there. I mean, there were a little bit of formalities certainly required. Make an own presentation, get in touch with the people. Here's an example, the multidisciplinary team proposing the Italian Network for Sustainable Agrivoltaic. So that was presented there. I call it just the marriage of natural and artificial photosynthesis. It was quite successful, very well attended. So you can use the EUBCE also now as a forum to make things known without writing an abstract and going through a scientific peer review, just to use this platform as a forum for you. We increased the number of ways to participate. So obviously it's now seamlessly from iPhone to tablet to computer to a big screen as I was using it. On the third picture, you see even you can take the right coffee cup for the presenter and can be relaxed and listen and watch it anytime on this one. Now, there was a game hidden, and I think you saw it. Maybe you were sometimes unnerved whenever you booked something, you got this 10 points extra. Clearly, it's made in order to catch you a little bit to use also other features of this full platform. It's quite controversial. I know people which really loved it. I know people which hated it. Let us see what we're doing there in future. But it was really thought in to make you aware of what all this platform is having ready for you. Now, we had a very active participant, and unfortunately we didn't have an award for the most active participant. Probably you know him all. Yukihiko Matsumura, whether he's still awake and listening to it, compliments to all your life and very good question to almost all of the presentations. And this is to honor one of our best session chairs, Giuliano Grassi. He's the founder of the European Biomass Conference and Exhibition more than 40 years ago, and he's still active and made a very good session chair in the conference. By chance, I found that we have a first women-only session. So from session chairs to presenters, women only. Very good. By the way, the overall figure, I think, is around a third or 33 or 34% of all presentations were female presenters. It's very good. Always, as usual here in Florence, I enjoyed this good atmosphere. There's a lot of people always ready for a nice, to make fun, but also to work very, very serious and very thoroughly and very concentrated. So this is my thank you to the team. It was splendid here. You were very professional, and it's due to you that this conference is such a success. And let me just hoping that you're next, see you next year. And I think there will be a kind of homage at all the ETA stuff before I move on to call Guillaume Boissonnet for the real last word of this conference. Yes, it does. So you see all the great people contributing to this conference. It was a really great job, and I'm there to the next year again to see you again there. Okay. So this hands me over, I think, to Guillaume for the real last word of the conference.
Yes. Thank you, Heinz. Thank you for introducing me. I think it will be, I hope. Uh-oh. It will be okay now.
Yeah.
Heinz, can you?
Okay. I think I see. I need to make this. No, I think
it's okay.
I can't.
It's okay. Okay, it's okay. Ernesto said it's okay.
I think it's not perfect.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. It's really an honor to be the one who closed this session on this week again, as last year. Well, it's time to say au revoir, and you can be sure that the adventure is ongoing. So on behalf of the executive committee, I would say that this EUBCE edition was again a special one, but we saw and we felt a little difference compared to last year, and it was very positive. Well, as Heinz already says, I want to thank all of you and congratulate all the presenters and organizers. I think it was a very, very good session, even if we were online only. A special thanks to Nikolai for his unfailing implication, for his continuous support to the conference, and for his strength as our EUBCE technical program chair. I think it's very important he's here to support all of us. Well, it was, as far as I can say, an outstanding week. Because I think we found out that we are a real biomass community, wider than only European and community, should I say, fellowship perhaps. What Heinz already mentioned, but I think it was very interesting that we had a huge USA, India, and China, and more widely America and Asia involvement in this conference, and it was very good. I think we had this year a higher visibility of the positive impacts of biomass utilization. As we said, there is no climate deal without sustainable biomass management, that's clear. And as Jennifer Holm said at the opening, we should not simply limit ourselves to directly substituting fossil fuels products, chemicals, but we have also to carefully consider a new way that society can thrive in the future with innovative, simpler, and cleaner everyday products. And it's important, the question of responsibility. And I think it was also very interesting that the new form of the industry track came across. I think it was very good. So we all know that biogenic solutions exist for climate recovery, especially bioenergy, but also biomaterials and biomolecules. And we all know that research and institutions are very important in the field, and we also know that the industrial applications will be very important in the future. Okay, just to finish, I've tried to find out some positive thinking, and I think that be responsible is a way of positive thinking. So I have just three quotes, three very rapid from perhaps the situation we live now to the future. The first is, it's no measure of health to be well adjusted to a profoundly sick society. I think it's important to say that everybody lives a strange period, and that we must adapt, but we must also change things. And in the way of changing, we know that we cannot change only on our own the things. We have to be together, and that's in a way that what Henry David Thoreau said when he said that a man has not everything to do, but something. And because he cannot do everything, it is not necessary that he should do something wrong. And I think together we can do something special. And to finish, I should say that our choices should reflect our hopes and not our fears in this period. Well, just remind that the conference is not finished yet. You have three events this afternoon. You can see here, I will not detail, but you have the pulp and fuel workshop about pulp and paper industry. You have the special events mentioned by Kyriakos, workshop and panel discussion, and a special workshop about biomass for landscape restoration. So you can enjoy again and this afternoon. So it's time to say goodbye and au revoir. So we are looking forward to meeting you next year and hopefully in person, I hope very much. Thank you and goodbye to everybody.